Obviously, this week is Thanksgiving week. I don't have to tell anybody that. Probably you've already got at least some of the food stuff that you need. Hopefully you've got the turkey out of the freezer at this point, because most of them take 3 or 4 days to thaw, at least mine do. And so hopefully it's already thawing. Don't get it out Wednesday night. Stick it in the oven Thursday morning. That may not work well. But this is Thanksgiving week. It's an opportunity. It's a time of reflection. It's an opportunity to look back at the past year and to think about God, and to think about God's blessings, to think about how God has worked in our lives. Obviously, Thanksgiving can be a couple of things. One is it can be very uplifting. It can be very encouraging. And hopefully all of us can look back over the past year and see a number of things in our lives that have encouraged us. You know, we can see how God met needs and answered prayer and brought us from where we were a year ago to maybe where we are now spiritually. There's things in all of our lives, I hope, that we can look back this last year and be thankful for, be excited for, be encouraged by, to see God working. Obviously, as well, it can be an extremely discouraging time. You know, as much, and again, in an hour and a half, I'll be speaking to a group of people that have had a difficult past year. And, you know, to many, going into this Thanksgiving and Christmas season is not an encouraging time. It's a discouraging time because things have changed in their lives and things aren't going perhaps the way they wanted them to go. So it's a time of reflection, and that reflection can be encouraging or it can be discouraging. When it comes to being thankful, I don't think that any of us would argue the fact that the giving of thanks to God is seen from Genesis to Revelation. The Bible is filled with thanksgiving. In the Old Testament, we see regular sacrifices that were set up by God to give the people an opportunity to thank God for what he was done, for what he had done. We often look at the sacrifices in the Old Testament as being an atonement for sin, and they were that. But there were also sacrifices that were given by the people on a regular basis to cause them to stop and be thankful, and to reflect on God and God's goodness. We see people like David in the Psalms regularly taking a break to give God thanks. And the Psalms are filled with thanksgiving. Even the Psalms that start with discouragement, like, where are you, God? Where have you been? Why are you so far away? Most of those Psalms end with thanksgiving. Because even in the psalmist David or others crying out to God with their questions, God almost always steps in and encourages them. And they find reason to give God thanks. And we get into the New Testament, and Christians are regularly called to thank God. In the New Testament, we even see Paul on several occasions referring to the sin of being unthankful. And so, you know, even in that, there's a challenge to us to be thankful. One of the things I'm going to look at tonight when I'm speaking in South Appalachian is how many times the Apostle Paul starts his epistles with thanksgiving. Almost always saying, I'm so thankful for you as a people. And then listing reasons why he is thankful for those specific people that he's writing to. And so I don't think any of us have any trouble understanding the need scripturally to be thankful. And yet, there's been a couple of verses that talk about thanksgiving over the years that have always been a challenge to me. And I know they've been a challenge to you as well, because some of you have asked me about them and said, I don't know how I can do that. I don't know about that verse. One of those verses is 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 to 18. Where the Apostle Paul says, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and then he says, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. And we probably, you know, don't struggle with the idea of pray without ceasing. That isn't a challenge, because, you know, anytime, hopefully as Christians, something comes to our heart and mind, we take it to God and we are thankful for it, or we are praying about it. But when we read the first part of that verse, which says, rejoice always, and we read the middle of that verse, which says, give thanks in all circumstances, we struggle with that. Because immediately, what comes to our minds is a list of circumstances that we are not thankful for. And the question immediately becomes, how am I thankful for that? Or others will say, because their circumstances are not widely known, others will say, if you only knew my circumstances, you would understand that that verse doesn't apply to me. And so the struggle exists of how am I thankful, how do I rejoice always in any circumstance that I face? Paul also speaks to that in Philippians chapter 4, when he says, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And so again, the struggle in that verse is the same as the last one. The struggle there is, he tells us again to rejoice, always. He tells us again to take our needs and our struggles, the things that would cause us to be anxious, and he says, take them to the Lord in prayer. Now, we don't struggle with that. But he says, take them to the Lord in prayer with thanksgiving. That we struggle with. None of us have trouble pouring out our heart to God and saying, God, do you know my needs? You know where I'm at? You know my hurts and my struggles and my sorrows? None of us have any problem with that, me included. But we do have problem at times taking those things to God with thanksgiving. Obviously, when we talk about how to do that, the answer is always in perspective. It's always in our perspective. It's always in how we see things and how we look at things. Now, I'm going to regress for a minute. How many of you have ever watched a chalk artist? Some of you? Okay. If you know, don't shout it out. If you know of one locally, I would love to have a chalk artist come sometime. I haven't seen a chalk artist live in years. And when I was a teenager, at the church there in Leroy where I grew up, I used to love to watch. There was a chalk artist that would come, not often, maybe once a year. And he would come, and he would put up his easel and the things that he did. And if you've seen them, you know what they would do. He would stand up here and either play music or talk, and he would be drawing on his easel. And as I'm watching him draw, of course I'm anxious because I want to know what he's drawing. But as I'm watching him draw, I would sit there and scratch my head and think, okay, is this guy really an artist? Because I'm looking at what he's drawing and it's like, that doesn't make any sense at all. It doesn't even look like anything. And I would wait and he would draw more and he would put colors and smear here and smear there and put marks here and marks there. And eventually it would like, okay, I think I see where he's going with this now. And he would get done and I would think, okay, I suppose that's okay. And then he would talk for a minute. And then he would do one of a couple of things, or maybe both. He would take the easel that he had just drawn on and he would change the perspective of it. He would turn it sideways or upside down. Or some of them didn't do that, but all of a sudden they would put a black light on it and turn the lights off. And all of a sudden you'd go, what looked like a mess is an absolutely beautiful picture. And then he used to give them away, and I never got one. I have no bitterness there at all. But the perspective, how you looked at what was being done, made all the difference in the world. Now, Rob, I need your help. If Rob could go turn the lights off for a second, please. Or at least turn down these on the side. I have a 2-minute video, and it's a little herky-jerky, but you'll get the point of exactly what I'm talking about this morning by watching this this 2-minute video. Excuse me, video. Go ahead, Rob. Yeah, turn this one down.
He was there.
okay. Like you said, may have been a little herky-jerky, but all the other ones I found were 10 minutes long, and I wasn't looking for that. But you can see the point that I was making there. And that, you know, when he starts drawing that, it looks like he's just throwing things here and throwing them there and making a mark here. And then all of a sudden when he turns it over, you're going, every mark had a purpose. Everything that looked like a mess to us was exactly where it and what it needed to be to ultimately make the picture that he was making. Now, I noticed something that I hadn't thought of before. I was just sitting here watching it. And maybe some of you did this. The first couple of times I watched that didn't make any sense to me at all what he was doing. But when I sat here with a completely different perspective, I could see the face of Jesus upside down before he ever turned it over. Because I was looking at it from a completely different perspective than I did the first time I watched it. And so our perspective makes all the difference in the world when it comes to being thankful in our lives. Even though we often don't know what the artist is doing. Everything he's doing has a specific purpose. And the same thing is true when we turn that around and look at that spiritually in our lives. God is the master artist. God knows exactly what he's doing. God knows the end picture before the canvas is put in. And everything that God brings or that God allows into our lives has a purpose and a plan to ultimately fulfill exactly what he wants in our lives. The problem that we have with perspective is that we don't see the end canvas. We see the marks and the work along the way. And our perspective, if we're going to be thankful for what God is bringing and allowing into our lives, our perspective needs to change. And our perspective needs to be one of confidence, knowing that even though I can't see the end picture, the master artist, God, can. And there's not a mark that would be allowed in our lives that doesn't have a important part of what that final picture is. In our road trip through the Bible, we've been looking at a number of different things in the Bible and hopefully getting an understanding of the Bible as a whole. And what I want to look at this morning is a couple of people that at least initially would have appeared as if they had no reason to be thankful. And turn in your Bibles to 2 Kings chapter 5. 2 Kings chapter 5, we are familiar with this passage of scripture. I looked at part of it just a few months ago when we were looking at foolish choices that people made in the Bible. But I want to back up and just look at this familiar account again for a few minutes. And I want to see the perspective, the possible at least perspective in the beginning of this. And then I want to see what the end perspective is when God turns the picture around and reveals what he's doing in the lives of these people. In 2 Kings chapter 5, beginning in verse 1, it says, Naaman, the commander of the army of the king of Syria, was a great man with his master and in high favor, because by him the Lord had given victory to Syria. He was a mighty man of valor, but he was a leper. Now the Syrians, on one of their raids, had carried off a little girl from the land of Israel, and she worked in the service of Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, would that my lord, speaking of Naaman, were with the prophet who was in Samaria. He would cure him of his leprosy. So Naaman went and told his lord, thus and so spoke the girl from the land of Israel. And the king of Syria said, go now and I will send a letter to the king of Israel. Now, we're introduced here in those first several verses to two people. And our introduction to them is pretty simple. The first one is Naaman. And Naaman, by the description given to him here, is a very powerful man. Naaman, as a powerful man, is the commander of the army of Syria. And it says here that he was well favored by his master, who was the king. Now, Naaman is the man directly under the king that is carrying out the orders of the king by leading his army into battle. The decisions in battle would have rested on Naaman's shoulders. The success of the battle would have rested on Naaman's shoulders. The failure in battle would have rested on Naaman's shoulders. He was an extremely powerful man. We also see here that he was a successful man. He was successful in battle. He had gone into battle, and through his leadership, the Lord had given victory to Syria. So he wasn't just a commander, he was a good commander. He was good in the sense that he brought victory home for the king of Syria. He was powerful, he was successful, he was a man of valor, he was a brave man. But then it went on and said that he was a leper. He had leprosy. Now I realize that the idea here of leprosy could mean some type of skin disease. And I suppose that it could. But in my opinion, it almost certainly here refers to the fatal disease that we often see referred to in the Bible. And if that is the case, then this disease of leprosy would have been a death sentence for Naaman. Now, whether it would have taken, you know, a lot of years or a short number of time, that I have no idea. But it certainly would have been a death sentence to Naaman to be diagnosed and to know for a fact that he had leprosy. Now, some suggested that, okay, if he had leprosy, he would be separated from the other people. That was only in Israel. That was only the Jews that did that. There were other nations, like Syria, who, if you had leprosy, allowed you to continue to fulfill your responsibilities. And so Naaman was allowed to continue to work, to continue to serve as a commander, and even though he had this disease of leprosy. Yet, even though he was able to go about his normal, everyday work and business, he had a fatal disease. And there was nothing that he could do about it. There was nothing he could do about it. He couldn't go to the doctor and take a pill. He couldn't go to the hospital and have a treatment. He couldn't go to somebody who could give him something that would cure him. Every day, every time he looked in the mirror, every time he saw the evidence of that disease in his flesh, Naaman would have realized he had a fatal disease. He would have realized that the end of his life was coming sooner than he would have wanted it to come. And you know, anybody that I've ever known that has been in that type of situation has had a lot of questions. And you can imagine what the questions are. Why? Why me? Why can't I do anything about it? Why can't I get past this? What have I done to deserve this? We can come up with all kinds of questions. It certainly would not have been an opportunity to be thankful. Not from that perspective. It wouldn't have been an opportunity to be thankful. Naaman possibly would have looked at his life and said, "What do I have to be thankful for? I have leprosy and I'm dying. I'm not going to continue to serve as I have. At some point, I'm going to become too weak. At some point, my body is not going to take it anymore. At some point, I'm just going to be in bad shape." It would not have been something to celebrate and be thankful for. And Naaman is in that position. We're also introduced in those first several verses to a little girl. I really wish it would have given her age. Because it'd be curious to me to know how old this little girl is. I get the impression that she's a little girl. Probably more than two or three, but I would guess not more than maybe 8 or 10. I'm just guessing that. I have no idea how old she is. But what she's referred to here is a little girl, a young girl. We see as well that she is a captive from the land of Israel, brought there by the success of Naaman. Brought there by the success of Naaman. And so she is a girl that was, a young girl that was taken from her family by the army that Naaman commanded. And she's not only taken from her family, she's brought to a strange land. And she's put in a position here to serve Naaman's wife. So, it doesn't say what happened to her parents. It doesn't doesn't say what happened to her family. It just says she was taken from there. And she was brought to a foreign land and made to serve the wife of the commander who caused her to be taken. Now, even though she was a servant of Naaman's wife, I don't think she was a servant in the sense that we often think of a servant today. We often, when we think servant today, we think slave, and we think of mistreatment. Now, I don't think that was the case. I think this young girl was probably well taken care of. She was serving the wife of the commander of the army. She did her chores and those type of things around the house. I believe she was well taken care of. But at the same time, I struggled to, I think that there would have been a struggle to be thankful. Because where would she much rather be? She obviously remembers being home, or she wouldn't have said, well, why don't you go see the prophet of God in Israel? She had to have remembered being there. She couldn't have been taken too young to remember those things, or the rest of the story here would have never happened. So she knew she was in a foreign land. She knew she had been taken away. And I have to believe that if most of us were in that situation, we would be extremely bitter and extremely angry. And we might have well said, what do I have to be thankful for? I'm in a strange place. I want to be home. I want to be with my family. I want to see my mom. I want to see my dad. I want my brothers and sisters. She didn't have any of those things. And yet, it's interesting because in verse 3, when she's thinking about Naaman, she says to her mistress, Naaman's wife, would that my lord were with the prophet who is in Samaria. He would cure him of his leprosy. I love, we could preach on this, and I won't because our time's going. Don't you love this simple childlike faith here? Don't you just love that? You know, she's looking at a man with leprosy. She says, oh, you know, I really wish you could be with the prophet of God. Because I know he'd heal you. I know he could do that. It's a simple statement of faith, a simple statement of concern about Naaman and his well-being. And then we see from there, Naaman went in verse 4 and told his lord, he told the king, thus and so spoke the girl from the land of Israel. And the king of Syria said, go now and I will send a letter to the king of Israel. So he went, taking with him 10 talents, I should say, of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, 10 changes of clothes. And he brought the letter to the king of Israel, which read, when this letter reaches you, know that I have sent to you Naaman my servant, that you may cure him of his leprosy. And when the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his clothes, and he said, am I God to kill and to make alive, that this man sends word to me to cure a man of his leprosy? Only consider and see how he's seeking a quarrel with me. Now, those are my favorite verses of this passage. You know, Naaman says to the king, hey, my servant girl says that if I went to where the prophet of God is, he would heal me. And the king of Syria says, okay, that's great. Here, let me write you a letter. And the letter says, you know, when the commander of my army gets there, I want you to heal him of his leprosy. And the king goes, he's trying to pick a fight with me. You know, here's the guy that just captured them in battle, defeated them in battle, right? And now he's standing before the king with a letter that says, I want you to heal this man of his leprosy. No, nobody had ever done that. Nobody had ever seen that. The king didn't have that kind of power. And he says, all he's trying to do is pick a fight with me. I know that's all he wants. It's interesting to me to see the contrast between this young girl's faith and the king's faith. The young girl says, yeah, prophet will heal you. The king says, what are you doing? Trying to pick a fight? I can't do anything. And so the king reached up and he tore his clothes. Now, tearing the clothes of a king was a major thing. And he tore his clothes because he was grieved. He tore his clothes because he felt like he was helpless and he was in danger. It was a time of mourning. It was a time of struggle. He reaches down and he tears his clothes. Now, here's the good news. They had Facebook back then. They didn't really. But I say they did because the news of the king traveling his clothes traveled faster than Facebook does today. And all of a sudden, Elisha hears that the king of Israel had tore his clothes in verse 8. But when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent the king saying, "Why have you torn your clothes? Let him now come to me, that we may know that there's a prophet in Israel." So Naaman came with his horses and his chariots and stood at the door of Elisha's house. And Elisha sent a messenger to him saying, "Go and wash in the Jordan 7 times and your flesh will be restored and you'll be clean." But Naaman was angry and went away saying, "Behold, I thought that he would come out and stand and call upon the name of the Lord his God and wave his hand over the place and cure the leper. Are not Abana and Parpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean?" So he turned and went away in a rage. But his servants came and said to him, "My father, is it a great word that the prophet has spoken to you and you'll not do it? Has he actually said to you, 'Wash and be clean'?" So he went down and dipped himself 7 times in the Jordan according to the word of the man of God. And his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. Elisha heard that the king tore his clothes. And he said to the king, "What you tear your clothes for?" He said, send Naaman to me. "Send him to me." And so, of course, Naaman gets on his horse and he takes his whole entourage and he goes outside the house of Elisha, the prophet of God. And Elisha certainly knows why he's there. And so Elisha sends his servant out. Don't miss what's happening here. This great man, this great commander is outside Elisha's house. And Elisha sends out his servant. And the servant says, "I have a message from Elisha. Go dip yourself in the Jordan River 7 times. And Naaman is, as we read, Naaman is filled with a rage. He's upset. Why? Number one, he sent the servant to talk to him. Doesn't he know who I am? Number two, Elisha didn't come out and wave his hands and call upon God and say, you know, heal this man of his leprosy. He said, go dip yourself in the Jordan River. And Naaman says, that's a filthy river. I could go home and dip myself in one of those rivers. That would be much cleaner. And so in a rage, he turns and he begins to leave. And thankfully, Naaman's servants say to him, "What are you doing? You know, if he'd have asked you some great thing, you'd have done it. All he said is dip yourself in the Jordan River 7 times. Can't you at least try that?" So Naaman reluctantly says, "Okay, I'll try." And he dips himself in the river 7 times. And when he comes out of the water the 7th time, his flesh is made whole like that of a little child. He's healed. He's healed. And there's a lot more to this account. But he's healed here. He's made whole. Now, what I want to look at just for a minute is skip ahead to verse 15. Then he, Naaman, returned to the man of God, he and all his company, and he came and stood before him. And he said this, "Behold, I know that there is no God in all the earth but in Israel. So accept now a present from your servant." He comes back to Elisha and he says, "Now I know there is a God. Now I know that the God of Israel exists." And I thought, you know, at this point, God has picked up the easel and he's turned it upside down. And at this point, Naaman is saying, "Now I understand. Now I know why I had leprosy. Now I can see the full picture. What had previously been looked at as a struggle suddenly became an element of thanksgiving. What was a question mark before suddenly caused Naaman to say, I praise the God of Israel. Because I now know that he exists, and I now know that he is the only God." As we apply that this morning, ask yourself this, or I'll ask you this. What is the leprosy in your life right now? What is the leprosy in your life right now that maybe keeping you from being thankful. Maybe it's sickness, cancer, financial issues, family issues, work issues, personal issues. Maybe things that everybody around you know all about. Maybe things that nobody around you knows a thing about. There are many things that can come into our lives that can easily keep us from being thankful. It is far too easy to focus on struggles and disease and difficulties and ask ourselves, or it's far too easy to focus on those things and never take the time to be thankful. Because our perspective is in the wrong place. We're looking at the picture upside down. We're looking at a picture that we just can't figure out. I heard someone again the last couple of weeks say to me, and it bothers me every time I hear this. I heard somebody, and it wasn't somebody here. I heard somebody say again to me the last couple of weeks that faith is believing in something that we have no evidence for. And I don't like that. I don't like that. Because that is not what faith is at all. Faith is not hoping in something that I have no evidence for. Faith is hoping or believing in something that we know is true, even if we can't see how it's going to be carried out. And our perspective in the midst of the struggles in our lives needs to be one of faith. It needs to be one that says, I don't know how God is going to use this struggle. I don't know where it's going. I don't know how God is going to use it. But I know by faith that God will use it. I know that there's nothing that comes into my life that God doesn't have his finger on. And I know that there's nothing in my life that God will not in somehow use to complete the portrait that he's painting in my life. And I don't know when it's going to be, but I praise God that either in this life or in eternity, God is going to turn the picture upside down. I'm going to go, wow, look at what God did. Look at how God worked. I may not have liked the process. And I may not have been thankful for the process. But I'm thankful for the result. And if it wasn't for the process that God used, the result would have never been there. And I don't think Naaman for one second said, man, thank God that I had leprosy. But I do think that after verse 15, he said, thank God that he allowed me to have leprosy. Because if I hadn't had it, I'd have never known God. I'd have never known who God is. This morning, our faith is in the written word of God, the promises of God. Our faith is in our experience with those things. And my experience is borne out. There's a lot of times that I thought maybe God had failed. But my experience says he didn't, even though I thought he had. My faith is also, to some degree, in the experiences of others like you, who are constantly testifying, let me tell you how God used this in my life. And our thankfulness comes from the perspective of God's working. It comes from faith in knowing that he will, and knowing that someday he's going to turn that chalk art over, or turn on the black light, and we're going to say, now I get it. Now I get it. Well, let's take a moment now. Father, I thank you this morning for your word. I thank you for the confidence that we can have by faith in you, knowing that you will work. You have worked. You continue to work. You have promised to work. And Lord, I just thank you that we can live in tremendous confidence of those things. And even this week of Thanksgiving, Lord, every one of us is going to be tempted at some point to focus on negatives that are in our lives. And we can't deny them. They're there. They hurt. They're painful. And they will continue to be that. But Lord, I pray that in some way we would be able to grab a hold by faith of the fact that even though those things are unpleasant, in the long run, you are going to use them. And you are going to, in some way, bring us one step closer to where we need to be because of those things in our lives. And Lord, with that perspective, I pray that we would consistently cry out in thanksgiving for who you are and the fact that you are indeed working in our lives. We thank you.